end of the course. And the last person is also not coming to the class, then the course ends. Okay. Basically, I am not very sure about across the cross section what is the background. So therefore, I assume the infimum and start at the as beginning as possible. I'll give you a list of textbook references in the next class or two, but I will not be following any book per se, because the subject is each person has his own way of doing, and particularly when we are doing it for an heterogeneous audience, it's going to be even worse or better or whatever it is. Okay. Many of the textbooks are written in a very terse manner. Somehow or the other, of course, analysis in the border of the so-called aristocratic pure mathematics and the commoner's applied mathematics. So the terseness goes on increasing as we go towards further and further pure mathematics. And you reach a level where the author's main aim is that the reader should not understand what he understands. Therefore, many of these books will be very, stingy about space, explanation, and minimal things like that. And you will find me also saying, most often saying, the proof is left as an exercise, as I said. So the main aim of the course is not to give detailed proofs of everything most of the time. Sometimes I'll give detailed proofs, sometimes I will not. But whenever I don't give the proof, at least I will say the position of that theorem, why we needed it, and maybe indicate what are the ideas of the proof, if not the details. Okay. So since there is a recording that is proposed, which may be uploaded after some time, not immediately, okay, don't upload it immediately, then there'll be nobody in the class next time. Okay, so we'll hold back with a time delay of about 1 year. We'll upload it, and so then you can. Okay, right. Therefore, certain things I will write very quickly or talk only, because you can always play back and see. All right. I do not know where to start. Okay, so therefore, what I will do is I will make a small beginning to get certain conventions set right, so that that's the convention that I would follow. So basically, our aim is to study functions. Okay, well, that's very in all its glory, in the sense that. In a modern language, probably interpretation is analysis and synthesis is what they call it, okay? The analysis and synthesis of a function. And so we would like to make the notion of function a little general. So let's make that thing a little bit. So by a function, okay, let me even say we denote a function f from a to b as just this. Okay, whatever that means. Okay, this is only a notation, it doesn't say anything. So you see that there are certain package that goes along with the notion of a function. First of all, a is a non-empty set. And that's called the domain of the function. And B is another non-empty set. It's called the codomain of the function. In future, I'll simply write DF for domain and then code F for codomain. And then what this fellow does means he codes every element of A as some, the coded word is in B, that's all. So with each A, in A is associated a B, a unique B. In B, which we denote by FA. And this whole process, we say that S is coded as FA. Now, by this definition, we are automatically excluding multi-valued functions. Okay, we are, with each A, the value is uniquely determined. It's not multiple values are not associated with anything. So the multiple valued functions are we studied later at a much later stage. So at the moment, these are called single valued functions. Okay, for every A, there is only one value associated. Okay, so the package, therefore, for a function, there must be a domain, there is a codomain, and there is this rule. These three together give rise. If any one of these is changed, we get a new function. So if we want to identify a function, all these three must be identified. So to make the point clear, so just let's say, let's take a function f whose domain is, say, the integers. This is the notation for integers. And the codomain is the real line, the real numbers. And the rule is that FA in DF is mapped to FA, which is A squared minus 2. So you square the input and subtract 2. Okay. And that's the function. But then look at another function, G, whose domain is R, the real numbers, codomain is also R. And the rule is also the same, square the input and subtract 2. These two are two different functions. The codomains are the same, the rule is the same, however, the domain of definition is different. So these two have to be treated as two different functions. So f and g are different functions. As df is not equal to dg. Okay. Many a times I will be very unorthodox in the sense that will not follow the sequence that most of the textbooks follow. Okay, so unorthodoxy is a mark of confusion, so I'll be highly confused from that. Now I want, suddenly I will look at this. Two examples from a different point of view, okay, which may which we will come up with a much later stage, okay, but all we continue till that stage. Now, if you look at these two functions, these two are different. The only place where they are different is in the domain, and the domain of f is a part of domain of this is dg. All this. The domain of f is a part of domain of g. So we observe domain of f is contained in domain of g. Codomain of f is the same as codomain of g. And the g a is the same as f a for all a in domain of f. We write this as G restricted to DF is the same as F. Whenever you restrict the values A to be in the domain of F, the F and the G take the same. We then say G is an extension of the function F. So we say G is an extension of F if one, df is contained in dg, codomains are the same, and f g restricted to df. We denote this by f precedes g in the partial order notation, if you are familiar with it. Of course, one of the very fundamental problems in functional analysis is to get extensions with certain properties preserved, okay, without losing certain properties. That's the fundamental called Hahn-Banach theorem or the Ries representation theorem and so on and so forth. Now, with that in mind, I'll give you some examples, okay. Let's look. First of all, I'll introduce some more notations, okay. Suppose I have omega in a non-empty set. Okay. Then I'm going to denote by f. I should put f of omega or whatever. This is for the time being, I'll just take f. The set of all functions whose domains are subsets of omega and all have same codomain, say B for some B. So what is F? F is the collection of all functions which map DF to B such that DF is a part of all those functions whose domain is a part of omega and which map eventually taking values in a fixed set B. Okay, so there is omega and DF is a part of it and then here is B. So F will be a function from DF to B. We take all such functions by taking all possible subsets of omega. Then, if you look at that relation, that's a partial order relation on this collection. So then FG belong to FGH belong to F. Then F precedes itself. Every function precedes itself because all these conditions of DF is part of DF, codomain is the same, and they agree. Okay, so every function is related to itself or precedes itself, and then if F precedes G and G precedes F, then F must be equal to G and the transitivity implies F precedes H. So therefore, this is a partial order relation. I assume we all know what is meant by partial order relation, but sometime I will leave it. That is, these three properties hold. This is called reflexivity, it is called antisymmetry, and this is called transitivity. It's a partial order relation on F. So one of the fundamental problems eventually in some form or the other will do is, you are given one function here, some domain, and the function is defined. And it has certain critical properties which you are interested in. Okay? And now you would like to get an extension of that as far as possible, if preferably defined on all of omega, such a way that the extended function has still those critical properties. That is the fundamental extension problem. whatever be the critical properties that you are interested in. Okay. So one of the fundamental questions that was in function, this was the extension of a linear functional. So in that, therefore, with that in mind, I will give you the following example. Okay. For some of which I will leave as questions. Okay. Now let's take omega to be R3. And let's look at F. What is F? Therefore, it is the set of all functions. I'm going to look at this, that the DF is part of R3. Well, there are many more restrictions I'll put, but for the time being, I'll just make a very simple statement of these things. I will not be very rigorous about these things. Okay. So therefore, a part of our three-dimensional space, I have a function defined. Okay. Now let us take all those parts to be subspaces. Okay. So like one-dimensional line or a or DF to be a line or a plane or the whole space. Okay. So let's take for the time being the DFs are all subspaces. So now let's take this function, so f. Let us take df. Df must be part of the three space. Let's take the xy plane. How does the xy plane we will write? It is a set of all vectors of the form x1, x2, 0, and where x1, x2 are real. Okay. So set that x1, x2 are real. So I got the function domain is defined. The codomain is the real number. So it's going to associate a number with it. And so I have to give only the rule by which this vector is associated with a number. So let me even make it simpler, okay. X1, 0, 0. Now, therefore, what is it that I have got? Only I have taken the x-axis in the three-dimensional space. So I have a function which is only defined on the x-axis. What is the rule? How is it defined? So x1, 0, 0 has to be associated with a number, so let's say 3x1. So what is that? It is actually in one dimension is fx equal to 3x. What sort of a function is that? It's a linear function. Okay, it's a line. If you draw fx equal to 3x, you will get a line. So it's a linear function I have defined on a part of R3. Called a linear functional. I will not use those words at the moment. So now, I will do some things here off the cuff, okay, which not intended to be at this place, but still. So what is it that it is doing? It is taking a vector and it's associating a number with that. Okay. So what we'll do is, we will have some kind of a quantification of the vector, and then that will measure what you started with, and we have the number which you ended up with. We'll compare the two. Okay, it's like doing a bit of elasticity. I had a string, I pulled it, now I'm going to compare the original length to the new length, that's all, a bit of. So what I am going to do is, how am I going to measure, quantify the vector? For example, I will use the following notation. For any x in R3, we define, for example, okay, mod x1 plus mod x2 plus, that is what, how you travel to reach that point from the origin, okay. You are allowed to travel either horizontally or vertically or upwards, okay. And see how much distance you have to travel from the origin to reach the tip of the vector, and that distance is called the quantification. So how far away you are from the origin. And then I have f of x. F of x is a number, so I can also measure it by always by its modulus. Any number is quantification is by its absolute value. So I originally I had this much, now I got this much, I will compare this, the new length versus the old length, okay. Right? I hope I am making myself clear. So I am naming a transformation, I am comparing the new length with respect to the old length. What could go wrong when I, what in what I wrote? The denominator could be zero. So let's assume x is non-zero, okay. So let us look at this. What is this actually equal to? 3x1 by result. Because for f, I am looking only at, f is defined only in, yeah. So look at all the non-zero vectors in df and find out this elastic chain that is taking place for each one of these vectors. So take every vector in df, calculate its new length, compare it with its old length, look at this ratio. Okay, that ratio gives a sort of idea at each point how much damage this elasticity is doing. Okay, how much you have stretched, like, okay. So now I would, this is exactly equal to 3. So therefore, whatever you do, the maximum damage you can do is precisely 3. Okay. That gives a measurement, some kind of a quantification of this elastic transformation. That ratio we got finally, the maximum damage, that gives you an idea of what could go worst with respect to this. We denote this as a quantification of that function f. Okay. Now this we could do for every function. Here we were restricting ourselves only to df, vectors in df, because f is defined only in df. Now let me give you another function. G, d of g is R2, that is all vectors of the form what is this now geometrically, the xy plane, which is much bigger than the real number. So clearly you see that df is contained in dg. I'm already thinking of an extension. And again, the same codomain, I define x to gx as say 3x1 plus 2x2. Now I have a elastic transformation now on the bigger picture, on the plane. Now the domain of G is bigger than domain of F. The domain of F is part of the domain of G. By putting x2 equal to 0, I get the domain of F. So df is contained in dg. Df is contained in dg. And g restricted to df. For df vectors, x2 is 0. So gx will be 3x1, which is the same as the F. So g restricted to df is the same as, And therefore, G is an extension of F. So F is less than equal to G. I got an extension, but this extension preserves that maximum damage. That still, for this extended function also, if you now calculate gx by and then look at the maximum x not equal to theta, x belong to dg, that is still 3. This is what I call as the measure of g, measure of the transformation g. So I have an extension of the original function which preserves this quantification of that, the elastic property of that transformation. The same elastic property is lifted to, the same elastic limit is maintained at the extended function also. Okay. So these are called norm preserving extensions. Now you find f is linear, g is also linear. So I had originally a linear transformation which had a certain elastic limit. It has been extended to a bigger set, again as a linear, but again preserving the same elastic limit. So these are called extensions of linear functions. But suppose I had put here 6, that would not have worked. It would be an extension, all right, but it will no longer be preserving that elastic limit. Okay. So our idea is to look at such things where certain those such properties are preserved. I will give you another example and then raise a question and leave it as an exercise, because consider this function h, dh is all of R3, dh is the full space now, and domain is the same, x to hx rule is hx is 3x1 plus 2x2 plus 3x3. That is still linear. Right, and you will find that G, F is extended by G is extended by H, and the elastic limit of H is still 3. So what we have got here now is, from a small piece in the one-dimensional subspace, we had an elastic function. We are able to extend it to the same linearity maintained, the same elastic limit maintained to the whole space. Such a thing is possible in a very general setup, is what is known as the Hahn-Banach theorem in functional analysis. Okay. I will raise one question, okay? And then I will answer questions if there are any. Okay. If H is such that dh is R3, x to hx is equal to alpha x1 plus beta x2 plus gamma x3, where alpha, beta, gamma are real numbers, then under what conditions on alpha, beta, gamma will H be an extension of F such that it still has the same elastic limit? That's an exercise. If you look at these exercises, then you will understand Hahn-Banach theorem well. and also Ries representation theorem. When I write the next one, is that clear? Any questions? Okay. If you don't have a question, I have questions. Question two. In question two, for example, here, if I had put 2, it would still work. If I had put 1.5, it would have worked. If I had put 3 here and 2 there, it would have worked. Okay, therefore, there are many extensions. There are many extensions of F to the whole space which have the same elastic limit. Okay, so now find what are all the possible extensions, what conditions are required on alpha, beta, gamma to get all the extensions. But now look at the other way around. Now I will change the whole process of measuring. I will use certain units for measuring or certain way of measuring things. Suppose I change the whole process. For example, I measure a vector now by its usual Euclidean length as the crow flies from the origin to the point. Previously, it was what is known as the Washington DC metric. You are allowed to go only like this. Okay. But actually, Washington DC streets are not like that. I have told this many times. My professor, one of my friend philosopher professors, who is no more, and Professor Venkatraman was there in Madurai University and later at University of Hyderabad. Later he settled in Pondicherry ashram. He used to call this as Pondicherry, that metric, as the Pondicherry metric, because apparently the roads are much better there, horizontal and vertical. Okay. So if ever, certainly it's not Bangalore metric. Okay. All right. So now with this, then how should I define the quantification of F? You look at the value that is still a real number, but now look at this and look at the maximum x belong to df and x not equal to theta. F is the same, the original one dimensional 3x1 defined. Now you see, you want to extend it to the whole thing, whole space. Will it be possible? How many extensions I get? Again, my extension must be of this type. Alpha x1 plus beta x2 plus gamma x3. Then, under what conditions will hx equal to alpha x1 plus beta x2 gamma x3 will this be an extension of F to R3 such that the same elastic limits are now maintained. Now the elastic limit measurements is through this measurement. Basically, that the answer that you get for this question in the most general setup is what is known as the Ries representation theorem in Hilbert spaces. Okay. Okay. We'll be looking at these things. So the one of the things that sometime or the other look at is this ideas of extensions, and particularly extensions in the linear situations. Okay. Another point which I want to make is, in a sense, that clarifies certain abuse of notations. So suppose that now I have a function from a set A to B. So I have I'm going to introduce a notation now. Suppose I I take a part of B, let's say E. This notation will be very useful, many times we'll be using it. So suppose I take a part of in the codomain, okay, and this notation is used umpteen number of times. Then what I do is I find that part of A which gets focused onto E. What does that mean? That part of A whose codes are all in B. That is that part of A for which F of A is in B. So I am going to define, look at all those points A in A such that their code is in E. Their code is in E. Okay. And this is denoted by inverse E. That inverse notation is an abuse there. Okay, anyway. So therefore, what we are trying to see is, it's like if you are a cricket fan, you will see nowadays they have totally infinite number of useless statistics that they will be showing. One of the statistics is like the pitch map. Okay, how many balls he bowled, the 4 meter, good length, short, etc., etc. Okay, I don't think the bowler ever aimed there. He just came, ran and bowled, it fell there. Okay, anyway, so but our statisticians have to have a job and they do all these things. So what we are doing is the pitch map and say this is the good length spot. We are trying to collect all the balls that he bowled which fell on the good length spot. That's all. Okay. And he may be a bowler like me, which no ball pitched on good length spot. So therefore, F inverse E could be empty. Okay. It is possible that for some E belonging to B, F inverse E is empty. Clearly, one of the most dangerous words in maths is this clearly. F inverse of B is what? Somewhere in the pitch it should fall. Decent, I hope it doesn't bowl wide. All the balls would have fallen definitely in B because the codomain is B. Everything, the value is in B itself. So whichever point you take, it's going to fall in B only. So therefore, F inverse of B is whole of E. I'll just write a few things. I want you to make sure that this F inverse is idea is a nice idea. It preserves many operations on set theory. For example, if I have two sets, E1 and E2 in B, I look at F inverse of E, it will be F inverse of E1 union F inverse of E2. And instead of 2, I can take 3, I can take any number, still it will work. So F inverse will preserve union. F inverse of a union is the union of the F inverse. So F inverse of union of E alpha, all some index set, is union of alpha, F inverse of E alpha. Similarly, intersection and then F inverse of E complement will be F inverse of E complement. So they are all interchangeable. Inverse and complement are interchangeable. Inverse and union are interchangeable, etc. These properties will be used to prove many things about sigma algebras, about properties of CDF of a random variable, blah, blah, blah. Everything, many things connected with a function. Okay. Now this notation of inverse should not be confused with the inverse of a function. So for that, first of all, now I will introduce certain notation. So suppose I have F mapping A to B. Now for example, from here, I am coding this fellows to B. F is a code. F may be a bad code. Namely, two fellows may end up with the same code. So F of A may be equal to F of A1. Okay. So therefore, decoding becomes a confusion. We don't know when I have a code whether it was A that was coded, whether it was A1 that was sent. So that sort of problems may arise. And further, I may not be using all the codes. Certain codes in the code book may not have been used at all. So if we had a nice code, what's a nice code? Everybody has a distinct code, and every code in the code book has a pre-code. So such functions are called invertible functions. So to get to that idea, suppose I have a function from A to B, I introduce the notion of one-one function. One-one function is a starting point of a good code. Each distinct fellows have distinct codes. That is, A1, A2 belonging to A, and A1 and A2 are different, imply their corresponding codes are different. Okay. And by on to, well, let me. Which I denote by RF, which we have seen in many codes, is the range of F is all those codes that have been used. Those codes which have been used in coding is form the range of F. So what is that? It is the set of all the codes which have been used means what? It must be the code of something such that B is equal to F of A for some A in. I'm looking at all the codes, all those B, which are the codes of something. So all the values taken by the function F, the collection of all the values taken by the function is called the range of F. Now the range of F is obviously certain elements in B, so it's a subset of B. If it is all of B, we call it as onto function. That is, all codes are used. So range of F is a subset of B. If range of F is equal to B, we say F is onto. Okay. Now, if a code is both 1-1 and onto, which means distinct fellows have distinct codes, and all codes have been used. So there is a perfect decoding. Give me any code, there is a decode, unique decode for that. That decode now which is defined is called the inverse function, okay? Or the decryption, whatever you want to call it. This is the encryption, then a perfect decryption is possible. Okay? That is called the end. So if F is 1-1 and onto, if F 1-1 and onto, then we can define G mapping B to A as G of B equal to A, where F of A equal to B. There is only one such A for which F of A equal to B. And there will be one such B because it is onto. Given a B, there will be an A such that this happens because it is onto. And there will be only one such A because it is 1-1. So therefore, we have a perfect function defined. This is called the inverse function. G is called the inverse function. So the inverse function is defined only when you have 1, 1 and on 2. But that other notation we introduce, f inverse of e, that makes whatever be the function, I can write f inverse of e for any set e. So here, we denote this function also by f inverse. So therefore, whenever I am talking of an inverse function, I will be writing f inverse of what? An element in B. Okay. Whereas the other notations, I would be writing f inverse of a subset of B. These two should not be confused with each other. Okay, these are two different notations. This can be written always. This can be written only when you have 1, 1 and on 2. 1, 1 and on 2 functions are called isomorphisms. This f is then called an, if f is 1, 1 on 2 from A to B, then f is called an isomorphism from A on to B, which means A and B are essentially same. Okay. One is talking the A language and the other one is talking the B language. F is the dictionary which translates the A language to the B language. So, if f is 1, 1 on 2, then it is called an isomorphism. Actually, this should be very carefully murdered. This is the set theoretic isomorphism. Okay. Isomorphism from A on to B. Now, given two sets A and B, we do not know whether there is an isomorphism. There may or may not be an isomorphism. If there is an isomorphism from A to B, we call the two sets as isomorphic. Okay. So, if there exists an isomorphism from A to B, we say A is isomorphic to B. Okay. So, for example, let us take A to B, the set of all natural numbers, say positive. So, A is 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, etc. And B to be the set of all odd numbers. Then, I can establish an isomorphism, F mapping A to B, defined as F of n is equal to 2n minus 1. F1 goes to 1, F2 goes to 3, F3 is 5, F4 is 7, etc. So, and this is 1, 1 and on 2 is an isomorphism. Therefore, A is isomorphic to B. Whenever it is so, we write this as A is isomorphic. Of course, A is isomorphic to A. If A is isomorphic to B, B is isomorphic to A, because there is an inverse function, and A is isomorphic to B, B is isomorphic to C, A is isomorphic to C. Okay. So basically, what does this isomorphism say? The isomorphism says, somehow or the other, it is that the two sets are identical, except that they are spoken in different languages, this all. And there is a dictionary. The dictionary is that isomorphism. F is the dictionary which translates A to B language. The inverse function is the dictionary that translates B to A language. So, if you want to look at these two sets, if they are identical, we say they have the same size. Okay. So now we bring in the notion of size of two sets. So in that sense, for example, even though I removed an infinite number of fellows from this, 2, 4, 6, everybody has been removed, these two sets are of the same size. So when you go to infinite sets, all kinds of crazy things will happen. Okay. You remove a lot of things and still you have not removed anything. That's the problem. See, we removed, but then still they are of the same size. It's only this fellow is the same as that fellow spoken in a different line. He has come back in a disguised form. You thought you removed him, but he has come back in a disguised form. So this mess that takes place is what we would like to study next. Okay. So in this direction, first of all, I am going to look at one specific example so that we understand where we are heading to. Okay. So basically, I want to next introduce the notion of countability, finite countability, and uncountability. Okay, before we ever get into this, let's look at one simple example to see some things could go wrong also. Not go wrong, there are things which we do not seem to appear right clear or there hidden. Okay. So let us take a set A which consists of just three elements. Let's take B. B is a set. Its elements are also sets. They are all subsets of A. So take all possible subsets of A. Okay, the set of all possible subsets of A. Because most of you know that it is going to be, how many are going to be there? Yeah, very good. So 2 to the power of 3. I would like the answer to come in the form of 2 to the power of 3. Okay. 8 doesn't give anything, okay? Any information. So let's say this is called the power set of A and denoted by 2 to the power of A. That is why the notation, it's a notation. It doesn't mean I'm raising the number to an exponent of set, okay? It's just a notation. It is denoted by 2 to the A. So what it does is, P has all the subsets and it takes an element and maps it to a patch. I'm going to look at a function from A to B. Okay. So any function from A to B will be mapping a point to a subset. A point to a subset. Now I'm going to construct a very peculiar subset in B. Yeah? Any questions? So I'm going to look at a very peculiar subset in B, which I'm going to call as X. See, let us say this A, we can try to locate whether it is in this patch or outside the patch. So what we want to do is, I am going to look at all those X's in A, such that, now if you look at Fx, what is Fx? Fx will be a subset of A. Now I want to know whether X is in that subset. So X does not belong to, I am going to look at all those points which do not belong to their image. Which do not belong. Let me give you an example. Okay. So I already have A to be A, B, C. So let us say F is defined as, I have to say what happens to each one of these elements. Say A is mapped to complement of the singleton set A. What is that set? BC. So A is mapped to BC, B is mapped to CA, and C is mapped to AB. Okay. So A is coded as the set BC, B is coded as the set CA, and A is coded as the set AB. Okay. So if you want to code that A, that part is colored. Say that those two numbers, B and C, are colored. Okay, in some color. Okay. So now, what is the set X in this context? A itself, because A does not belong to FA, B does not belong to FB, C does not belong to FC. So every one of these fellows belong to X, so X is A itself. So now this X is in D. So this fellow X is somewhere here. That is the fellow X, and that is all of that full set A. Okay, that set X is A. Now, is there anybody who comes and makes it as A? Is there any A for which F of A equal to A? No. So therefore, there is no A in X. In A, such that F of A equal to X. What does that tell about that function F? Yes? It is not onto, because X is a possible code. Everybody in B is a possible code. X is a possible code, and that has not been used at all. So therefore, it is not onto. Therefore, F is not now we'll see that, or I will state that, however hard you try, you will never be able to get an onto function from A to B in general. That is, take any set A, not necessarily AB. It may have 10 elements, it may have 200 elements, it may have 1 billion elements, it may have infinite number of elements. Whatever set you take and look at its power set, the set of all subsets as B, then from A to B, you will never be able to get a onto function. So here is a proposition. Let A be any set, and B, it's 2 to the A, its power set. Power set means the set of all possible subsets of it. There does not exist any onto function from A. There does not exist any onto function from A to B. So the way to show that some does not exist is to show that whatever function you take, you show it cannot be onto. Take any function, say it cannot be onto. To show that any function is not onto, we must show that whatever coding system you give, there will be some codes which will not be used. And to construct that unused code is this set. You always construct this code, this will never be used. Whatever function coding system you have from A to the power set, this particular code will never be used. Okay, so there, what does this therefore say? Let's say we will look at the details in the next class. Now, what does this say? This says that the power set can never be equivalent to the set A. A can never be equivalent to its power set. Okay. So therefore, there is some size difference. Okay, this fellow is of a different size than that. He is not saying no, no. And then at the same time, somehow or the other, everybody here can be identified here. How? To the singleton sets. Okay. So at least as many fellows here are there or here. Okay. A can be identified in the singleton set A. B can be identified with the singleton set B. So it looks like this fellow is at least is as big as A, but more big. Bigger. Because there are still some fellows left. No matter how hard you try to find codes which will match, you are never able to match. Okay. So therefore, there seems to be that you can always, given a set of some size, we can always go to a bigger size set. Now, how do I look at this small, big business? How do I define these things? And how do I identify these things? And there is a fundamental theorem called the Schroeder-Bernstein's theorem. Okay. And that will be the starting point of next lecture. Okay. So the idea is eventually use all these things and then get the picture about countable sets, uncountable sets out of the way so that we can start doing things, because this countability has a special place in certain properties. Okay, the countability provides certain niceties, uncountability provides certain difficulties. Okay. So in the next class, I will start with this idea, this function, and then get to the notion back to the equivalence, ideas of cardinality, countability, uncountability, and certain simple properties of these sizes or what are known as the cardinality of sets. These are important, and you will see that many things you know already, all you have to do is put them together. So this timing is okay, 5:30 to 6:30. There is one thing that I want to announce. Unfortunately, next week, Tuesday and Thursday are not suitable for me. I have already committed before this was fixed. I think the date I suggested, well anyway, I didn't expect. Okay. So if sometimes something like this, either whether it will be possible to shift to a Monday or a Friday, I want to check. How are Mondays? It will happen rarely, but it so happens it will happen next week. But if there is a serious problem, then we'll simply skip that week and go to the next. Or we'll do one thing. If a substantial number of people can adjust and come, we'll have the class and the others can catch up with the video or whatever it is. Okay. So we'll decide on Thursday what we will do in the next week. But right now the next class will be on Thursday at 5:30. Okay. Thank you.